Yes, begin, please. Yeah.
Okay, we are live now, right? Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So, a very good evening, everyone. Welcome to the recurring episodes of the Satyagraha Voices from Punjab and Haryana in the context of farmers' movement. We march on with the motto of tracking down the recent developments that are taking place as the protests from all across rages on and steps up its demand to achieve and attain the rollback of these laws. But there also are different dimensions and facets and a lot of elements that deserve our attention as far as what the teachings are coming out from these protest movements, these farmer movements. Is the fact about the emergence of women leadership, the highlighting the vital importance of women in these protest movements and the fact that it needs to be highlighted from a socio-economic, aspect, something that cuts across regional barriers, something that cuts across our own ideologies, our own political inclinations, and something that wholly and solely deserves critical engagement. As far as role of women is concerned in building up the grassroots and building up the foundations of these farmer movements, and we'll be discussing and deliberating upon same. And today we have with us to shed light on this and to take forward this conversation from this dimension, we have Ms. Kankakshi Agarwal, who is a policy enthusiast, a gender activist whose research centers around the intersection of society, gender politics, intersectionality, and gender. She is currently working with CPR in the technology segment and has previously worked in crucial role of designing the manifesto of the general elections in the year 2019 and the general Lok Sabha elections of 2019. Then she has previously done her master's from TISS Bombay in urban policy and urban governance and policy. And I take great pride in introducing her as a former public policy fellow at Citizens for Public Leadership, because this is where I was also a public policy fellow just a week back. And she is a powerful writer, a vocal feminist, a renowned speaker in educational institutes like Symbiosis and MIT, to just name a few. She's the founder of Netri Foundation just a couple of years back, as soon as she wrapped up her stint at CPR. And my first question to you, Kankakshi, is obviously, how are you doing? And can you just let us and let the audience know about what work you are doing? What mandate is there of Netri Foundation? And what have you been able to achieve? And, what's the vision that Netri Foundation works with? Over to you.
Thank you so much for that very, very humbling introduction. Just a correction, now I work with a different division in CPR. It's not technology anymore, but that's a consultant role that of course, you're not updated about it, but my engagement with CPR keeps changing. But more than that, thank you again. And I think we are here to discuss something important. And I was just saying before we even started this conversation that how there needs to be a dialogue and, of course, bringing a gendered perspective to something that is unprecedented. Like last year, we saw this virus come into our lives, which was called most unprecedented thing that we have witnessed. But it is not new. Farmer protests is something that we know is not new. It is if we look back at Atal Bihari Vajpayee's speech in the parliament and from the pedestals and rallies, he also addressed the nation and, always talked about farmer rights. Perhaps there has been an ongoing tussle between the laborers, the agricultural laborers, the landowners, the farmers, since we got independence, and even perhaps before that, because we are a largely, agriculture-based economy. Having said that, what we are witnessing right now is unprecedented. Why? Because the scale of it, the timing of it, the duration of it, the consistency of it, the warmth, the love, and women and children farmers' children and women also being at the forefront of it. Also unprecedented because we are hearing such unwelcoming remarks such as, why are women being kept at the
process? Yes.
So all of this just becomes very, very, I think there is always an irony that dies, you know, that whenever women are at the forefront or whenever they are leading, either it is something to do with, you know, somebody or the other will come and discredit their agency, or they will say that it's a women's thing. Why we don't see gender mainstreaming happening in every sector of life? And we'll talk about that. And that is perhaps Neeti's one of the biggest goals, right? Because Neeti, and my stint was with a political party when I worked with their manifesto, and I started Neeti right after. In fact, not even when I left CPR, I started when I joined CPR. I was out of a political party, and I thought, what if women in this country want to contest election? What if women want to be political? What if women want to find their pathways into politics? Because you and I and all of us can, right? But was there anything that we could Google and say, hi, I want to be in politics. How do I do that? And Neeti is exactly that. We are envisioning it to be the incubator. It is sort of India's first incubator, being envisioned from a very holistic perspective to give a political acceleration or an incubation to women who want to choose politics as a career. How can we make it sustainable? Now this is also a dialogue that we are more than happy to always host and engage with our participants and ask them, you know, what are your difficulties? To consistently work to, you know, reduce these access barriers in politics, because, you know, all of you will agree, and we'll get to that point of discussion at some point, that there are so many access barriers for women across sectors. Right. And from the protests to the politics, there's a, you know, wide spectrum of things. And why do protests happen, and then why they should convert into a political action? That's something that we can discuss about in length. But at the same time, Neeti is actually trying to achieve proportionate, effective, and adequate representation of women in politics. We run short-term, long-term programs. We do boot camps. Our upcoming program is specifically for West Bengal, Assam, and Tamil Nadu elections. What we do in these programs, we do digital trainings where you can come in and learn about gender and leadership, political communication, you know, build your political resume sorts. And we are doing the second cohort right now, and we had quite a success with our first when we did it before Bihar. So the idea is, like, if any one of you at any point would like to, you know, get in touch and just talk politics, I'm more than happy to do that. So that is a little bit about Neeti Foundation, but more than that, I would love to, also cement the idea that how social movements lead to women politicians, how social movements and protests can become these fertile grounds for nurturing leadership for future. I think that was also an expectation, and I had a conversation last week with somebody where we were talking about in the last decade, I would say, that there's a you know, takedown of these protests, and how do you expect future leaders to be nurtured if you're going to not be tolerant towards the opposing view or to the demands of the public? And then we'll talk about the trends backing women in politics. So I'd leave that to further discussion and hand it back to Simran.
So, I mean, exactly. You just, like, aligned the vision and the mandate of Neeti Foundation along with what is happening on ground, which is exactly what it is. And you just actually highlighted the recent remarks by the Supreme Court on why is there a need to be present, why is there a need for old people, old age people, right? Children and women to be there. And that actually takes me to a complete surprise, not just because of the sheer, nonchalant, or what can I say, just that kind of cold approach, but also there's a lot of data, you know, which we'll come over to, which there's a lot of data which says and which deserves and which, you know, which basically proves that there has to be a lot of reforms as far as role of women and increasing the role of women in agricultural workforce and the kind of diverse roles they have in, you know, the agricultural sector. But before that, before we come to the data and before we come to that, because, you know, see, we are policy enthusiasts, we will talk about data-driven processes and we will quote all of that. But before that, we'll have to lay down a specific context. And that context is about women leadership and social movements as such. And we have a rich history to that. We have a rich history as far as environment movements is concerned. If you go back to Chipko movement and Narmada Bachao movement, Niyam Giri movements, all of them had women as frontline warriors. There's no denying about that. There's no denying that there were, you know, women who have taken the charge, who've been in leadership positions, not just in leadership positions, but just carried forward the movement, you know, in their own way, for survival, for livelihood, for carrying forward social justice. And they, you know, it made those movements historic and what can we say, vital, yeah, in disciplines as they are. So if we can take the audience through those, that kind of discourse, and very recent example is obviously of the Shaheen Bagh and anti-CAA protest, right? I cannot think about anything more poignant or something that does not deserve to be wiped away or erased from memory at all. We need to celebrate that. We need to highlight its importance. So if we can, like, you know, lay down a discourse for the audience that how that just goes on to prove that role of women and how does a social movement progresses and takes into account different causes to achieve a certain, you know, what we say, spectrum in the society. Yeah.
Thank you again. Actually, see, here's an interesting point, right? What Kamala Harris recently said when she was taking the oath, like, you know, I'm going to be the first, but not the last. Interestingly, we keep getting reminded of how India has had a first prime minister and we've had a first woman president, and there were women, like, you know, first woman president has also been in India and there was also a woman prime minister. But this whole, I think what the problem continues to remain is that there are these role models. We take them and then we silo them. We're like, once in a generation, there will be a leader like Jayalalitha. Right now, it's a quiz. People can respond. How many women CMs are there in this country?
One.
Right? One.
Gujarat and West and East.
Right. One, two, right? So let's even say two. Like, we give the benefit of doubt, you know, ki bahut sara, whatever criticism that, you know, Mamata Banerjee faces, and, you know, Jayalalitha was such a powerful figure, but the moment you go and applaud her resilience, her power, there's a lot of criticism and well taken about her corruption, everything. Second quiz, perhaps, how many women CMs have been there in the history of Indian politics since our independence? Another random.
I think this awkward silence is a proof enough of.
No, I am sure that people would want to write. Do they want to put something in the chat? Okay. Somebody. Okay. Let's just say. Okay. No. So.
Honestly, can't think of a single one.
Huh?
I can't think of a single CM that I can't remember a single one. Yeah, that I get your point.
Yeah. So there have been 15. Let's go back to the Constituent Assembly. How many women were there in the Constituent Assembly when our Constituent, because we keep talking about our founding fathers, where are our founding mothers? So, somebody's on a, can you mute this person? Gulzarji, I think. Okay, I can mute him. Yeah. So, how many women in the Constituent Assembly? We remember the founding fathers, but where are our founding mothers? I keep asking. 15. Okay. How many Dalit women in that? One. How many Muslim women? One. Now, what? So, So there have been. We can't say that, you know, there haven't been women. Even if we go back to, and we recently celebrated, I think 103rd or 193rd, I'm sorry about that, but we celebrated the birth anniversary of Savitribai Phule. First and foremost, sort of an Indian educator and feminist. But at the same time, these, what exactly, I'm coming back to my point and saying that there have been women at the forefront of so many movements. You remember Rani Lakshmibai, but then you take them as an example and you silo them. You're like, Kubladi Mardani, par wo ek bar thi, right? Where were Rani's successors? Why don't we have this culture of, you know, there can be two, like many Ranis, and there can be like, we can be all queens of our own kingdoms. Because we try to say that women will come and, you know, handle the situation when there is an adversity. We don't see that they have always been at the back end, fighting even like in the most conspicuous or inconspicuous scenarios. Also, they've been at the forefront for so long. It's just that they come to the fore so rarely that we completely sideline them and marginalize them from our narratives. They are never mainstreamed into that. And this is exactly and precisely why that you and I have to continue to prove ourselves that, you know, we deserve to be in the protest. Why is it that women are constantly asked to prove their mantle, to prove their skills, to prove their intent? That, hey, I'm doing, and what I'm doing, I know what I'm talking about. Women being kept at the protest, like that is stripping women of their human agency. It's a violation of their constitutional dignity.
Fundamental right to protest.
The fundamental right, the constitutional dignity that, like, you know, that constitution gives dignity to each and every human being once they have reached their adulthood to decide what is good for themselves. Coming to the statistics, you know, women barely inherit 2% to 2.3% of the land. However, and this is from the ground, and I'm not going to flinch in sharing this. So what happened is, and this was last month, I was on the ground talking about contesting elections, okay, to women. And this is going to be a reserved seat. Now, this man who's sort of already preparing that, you know, even though it is going to be on paper, that this right is going to come to my wife on paper, I am going to become in charge. And he's already mobilizing the concept of Sarpanch Pati, and you have all been, you know, you're all familiar with it, I am hoping. So, wo tayar hai, ki usko, he has to sign, matlab, he has to just get the wife to sign things, and, you know, he has to take on the power, and he's doing everything in his capacity. Now, the conversation is very interesting because they've sent both their sons to school outside. They have decent land and everything. And I'm like, but aap unko kyun nahi rajneeti karne doge? Matlab unko karne do. Aap jeetoge to unke naam par na. Matlab wo jeetengi na. To unko rajneeti karne do. Tak nahi. To par aisa hoga to khet pe kaun jayega? Didi, rajneeti full time kaam hai. Hai na? Jab rajneeti full time kaam hai, matlab you need to mobilize, you need to go out, you need to interact with people, you need to go beyond the domesticated roles that have been assigned to the women, and they have to leave their, you know, Delhi se bahar jana padta hai. To haan to theek hai, chali jayegi. Nahi to didi, khet ka kaam kaun karega? Achha, to khet ka kaam wo karne ke liye hai. Achha, theek hai, khet ka kaam karti hai, to achha, wo bhi to bechne jaati hogi. Now she's cultivating. She's laboring on the field. She's doing 50% of the job. So then, achha, wo khet ka saman karti hai, to fir wo crops bhi to mandi bechne jaati hai. Nahi, didi, wo main karta hoon. Now, if one has to look at from a very public policy lens, from any pragmatic lens, the woman is doing the hard work. The woman is doing the labor. But where is her agency to negotiate for the pay that she gets for that crop? Where is her, like, she is not even in a position to bargain for the cost of the crops that she is toiling over. So she can't do rajniti, because apparently her time is going to go in the khet, and who's going to do that? And she can't even bargain for the crops that she's grown. Now, Like, so we are saying that they are not, so women are anyway not being economically advantaged, they're not being politically advantaged. What are we doing? What are we doing to our women? And what, and why is there an institution like the Supreme Court or the government of India and even the government of different and multiple states? I just put up a status today and I would love to get into the details of what I just like wrote 10 pointers on how the rules for Indian women in the new India, in the shiny India, in the digital India, in the India that we promised to ourselves. And I'll come back in a bit, but going back to your question on social movements, I just want to address one thing, that there are two ways women come into politics. One is dynasty, second is social movements. Dynasty has been, how do I say, it has been made the monster in the Indian politicking. Rightly so sometimes. Of course, dynasty shouldn't play the role it plays in deciding who should, be representing us. But at the same time, Amita Basu, she argues, and it's a beautiful paper, that how she says that dynasty has really, and you'll think that it has benefited upper caste women more, but it is equally benefited the Dalit and the, minority women. And you might want to look at that paper. We'll be happy to share, but the idea is that dynasty has enabled women, and when they come into power and we continue to discredit them by saying that they are dynastic women, we are again saying that women will continue, like women are such weak creatures, that even after they come in power, they continue to be dominated by men. So that narrative has to change. And second way is social movement. Somebody like a Sushma Swaraj, the way she rose to the ranks and her dignity, her ability to lead and be so calm and patient, and her demeanor was beautiful. And that was a different kind of, leadership that was born out of non-dynastic but social movements. And social movements have given beautiful leaders to this country, from, JP and even Atal Bihari Vajpayee, or everybody who's right now in power, by the way, has come to the power
from student movements and social movement.
Being a part of the student movement, movement, social movement. We were talking about Narmada Batao Andolan. The large part of it has happened in Madhya Pradesh, and I come from the state, and I know that the impact it has had on the, and we always say memorabilia of something. So I think the memorabilia of Narmada Bachao Andolan is very, very deep rooted in Madhya Pradesh's history and in the minds and the lives of people. Even if I'm not directly connected to it, perhaps it never happened, say, in Bhopal, but it was still happening in my ancestral villages, and people talk about it. A woman has had that power over a period of time, and we still continue to ask women to prove their mental. And I'll tell you why this problem also exists. This is my last point, and then we can continue. Because these are one women. We don't have a band of women. And this is another thing that we want to achieve through Netri, right? When I say adequate and proportionate representation, we keep on saying, why doesn't Smriti Irani don't do enough? Why doesn't Nirmala Sitaraman don't do enough? What we are sort of talking about, this effect of women banding together and leading the government. It is one woman, how much can she do? Like, that woman has fought to get a seat on that table, right? That woman has fought to be in that room. That woman has fought to speak in front of like 50,000 men. Now, we also want to put the altruistic burden on her to do everything. I'm not defending any of like Nirmala Sitaraman's or Smriti Irani's stance at this point, because we know, given that their power in the party, they are doing less. They are doing much less than they should and they can. But at the same time, this conscious development of feministic leadership is something that we must work towards together. So,
I mean, obviously, from social movement, there comes political avenues and there are barriers. But what is common in that political sphere and in that gamut of social movements is the devious attempt of patriarchal structures to clamp down on your agency. Like the fact that women still have to prove, despite having a history, despite spearheading Narmada Bachao Andolan or environment movements or God knows how many movements that are, you know, against for land rights, for livelihood, for natural resources, against, you know, any sort of exploitation, right? They still have to prove it. There's still a clampdown on agency. And I guess, and it just saddens me that there's so much of data to quote. And I, you know, there was a recent finding, which was by National Council of Applied Economic Research and University of Maryland study, which found and estimated that, you know, women form at least 42% of agricultural, 42% of agricultural workforce, but barely 2% own that land, right? And this speaks a lot about their role in the whole agricultural workforce, basically. And then there's obviously study of People's Archive of Rural India, which says that 2/3 are, you know, engaged in as cultivators and as agricultural laborers. Then there's the problem of unorganized labor as well. But just let's be focused on the whole framework of agriculture sector, because the session is about farm movements and farmer education, and how absolutely. The rollback of these laws can possibly initiate a conversation about the much needed reforms which can benefit women in the longer run, right? We have mechanization of labor, but women are performing the labor, but they're not paid for it, right? And that brings in the conversation of housewives not being paid. All of these are so similar that there's an uncanny dynamics that exists between these two, sets of conversations. Mm-hmm. And then we have so much, the fact that when the male farmer or any male member of the family dies by suicide, what kind of protection does exist for women? What kind of social security system are we talking about? You know, these are really like serious policy issue, like really ground level, I would say ignored, sidelined issues. And that is something that really deserves our attention. When we were discussing, when I told you like to highlight the discourse, stretching from the environment movements right up to the social movement, in this farmer movement specifically that has been going on since like 5-6 months now, there is a certain section, and I'm talking about Tikri border here, one side of the Tikri border, which is entirely dominated by women. And they are sitting with photographs of their sons or their husbands or any, you know, male member of the family who died by suicide, and they have nothing else but this protest to rely upon. So think twice or 10 times before you pass such comments, like what business, you know, do women have? I ask, where on the earth should else they be not for the protest, you know? So, and you know, the socioeconomic issues are obviously there, but then there is an issue of livelihood. There's this whole over-encompassing need for fighting for social justice that is completely impossible without the role of women, in spearheading these movements. You can add on to that.
Yeah, absolutely. You've set the context right. And in fact, like few data points that I would have anyway brought up. But as I said, that I do believe a lot more also in stories and, you know, this... apart from talking about data, which we all can find, if we have to break this issue down, right? If we have to say that, how do you want to envisage the role of a woman in the society?
Yeah,
it is going to be on so many factors, and they are going to be socioeconomic, political, right? And you cannot leave one. Like somebody, and I'll come to that, you cannot leave one pillar to work itself out, or you cannot ignore it and say, because I get a lot of, you know, sometimes flack on, oh, women are not even economically empowered and the labor force participation is falling. And that is very, very concerning. And it is happening much more in the rural areas, and I'll tell you, in the urban areas, sorry. And I'll tell you, on 11th of April, we hosted a session called Women in Pandemic, and we were sort of, you know, very, very new. Like there was only UN conversation, and then we did it, and we did it with a sarpanch from Bihar. And she, at that point, it was more predictive. Think about 11th April last year, we had just gotten into lockdown from 24th of March. 10, 15 days into the lockdown, and she had said, rural women to apna chala lengi, urban women, these women who are the wives of security guards, or men who have come and, you know, migrated from smaller towns, smaller villages to these, you know, smaller towns also and bigger towns also, who are in this this service sector, which is sort of unorganized or, you know, partially organized. And they have gotten used to a certain lifestyle, perhaps the blue collar job people. Their wives who are in the urban areas have gotten used to a lifestyle. Their children have gotten used to a lifestyle. But these women are going to not find so many jobs. In the rural areas, she made sure that, you know, women had immediately taken to stitching masks, immediately taken to doing whatever they can in terms of even painting the walls with social, you know, COVID awareness messages. That would also get paid because this is panchayat level work. Tum ek din ka kaam bhi itna sa bhi karoge, so you'll get some dihari for it. You'll get some, you know, basic wage for it. And she had talked about it such, like, so much in advance. And we are not right now seeing the impacts of it. So now, this is one aspect of it. And people do say that, you know, why are you working on the political aspect while there is so much to be done for, you know, economic empowerment of women? And I'm like, I'm not saying that I can have, one of the biggest partners that Netri usually has are these local organizations. We work with them, try to work with them in tandem, because if a woman has first crossed her social, you know, boundaries, achieved some kind of economic independence, that she goes out of her house, she's got something to do. And I think I'm a big fan of social capital. And I think that that is what is the key to everything. You talk about, like, in a fancy schmancy language, you'll be like, oh, I you know, networking in political circles or networking in corporates. That is what you and I are doing right now. We are talking to each other and, you know, getting to know each other, and this is part of networking. But this is exactly what translates into social capital at the ground level. The caste, gender, minorities are usually marginalized, or if I may say ghettoized, because they have very limited networks. Because we keep saying that, oh, we'll network based on certain aspects. We'll network based on your gender, your caste, or a certain, you know, class also. So that is why it is not that the social mobility, say, of Dalits or of women or of minorities is very hard, because they don't get too many options of the social capital. And I always believe that political capital will always be built on social capital. There is no two ways about it. So this, what you've just talked about, that women being at the forefront on the border. So how we see that issue is socio-economic political. What they were doing back in their villages with their husbands before losing their husbands to suicide because there was nothing to eat in the family, and now they are left to fend for it. We're talking about women actually doing what, say, again, I'll go back to Rani Lakshmibai example. She was fending for her state, and she was saying that nobody takes my house. Nobody takes away my child. Nobody takes away my agency to decide. Right? Now, in the same stream of thought, one has to look at how women participate. What do they have to gain and lose when they participate? We also see that women have a lot more to lose when they participate, right? Because they are losing their day's wage while they can be back in the village. And not only women, I think everybody sitting out there to protest. Right now, people say there are about over 3 lakh people. And they've been sitting there for months now, 2 months minimum. And the protest has been long going even before that.
In different states, yeah.
Yeah, so they're losing daily wage. And again, one has to look at the these impediments that are built by the society. Well, like, think about it. Okay, I was seeing this good friend story from the ground, and there were men who were bathing at 3:30 a.m. in the morning. Think about women having to do that, sitting on those boards. So we are not completely neglecting the struggles that there's still. It's not that women, if they are sitting there, they're not risking their safety, right? Or they are not risking their financial, physical, sexual, all sorts of, even mental health, right? They're they're compromised or they're victimized on each and every level. And we need to acknowledge that. We have to say that, okay, if women are there, shouldn't they be, you know, protected in like different camps? And shouldn't there be these makeshift toilets? Who is taking care of that? Because another thing is sometimes, and we saw that that is different in this farmers movement, that even, you know, men are cooking amazing pizzas like these.
Yeah, I mean, I was just about to come to that.
Yeah, so the cooking, the burden of cooking is at least not solely, you know, landing on women. That is a great thing. But at the same time, because we can, and again, the problem of conservation, right? Somebody who's never had to, you know, shy away or had to think twice or bat an eyelid before changing and, you know, taking off shirts in the public space, how will they even ever think about that these women are sitting there? They might also want to bathe, they might also want to use washroom, they might also be losing, you know, so much back home in terms of wages. They have never done it, and they're not being represented by somebody who's done it. So I think what we generally lack is our understanding of gender, the mainstreaming of gender, and especially because we don't have a lens for it at the top. And this is long overdue, that women be talked about or from the perspective of what agency do we give them in the conversation when we are talking about it, right? We cannot, like, I cannot take mic for a Dalit woman when she's on the panel and speaking for herself, because you need to pass the mic. And you cannot, like, our governments, our media, even each other, we need to stop speaking for each other, right? We need to give that space and let women speak for themselves also. I don't know how many people are really going there and just recording women's perspective. How is that, you know, narrative, media narrative? Like, while there is this trolley times, that's amazing, but did we think about where is women's narrative getting, you know, featured? That's something, you know, it's a constant work, and it has to.
Yeah, I mean, I'm actually reminded of I'm actually reminded of the fact that when I first went to Tikri border, and there was a woman cashier there who gave my father a chance to speak on electricity amendment with. And I was so happy that, okay, finally I have a, you know, I have a female face who's there and collecting cash, like when you deposit, when you donate something to the protest. And there she was, and then she told me that my daughter has set up a running library and she is working on Trolley Times edition. And I'm like, wow. And then a month before that, there was some long lost batchmate or classmate of mine. She said, I want to be involved in the protest, but somebody is discouraging me. And I'm like, who? Somebody who's like spearheading the protest, but he's discouraging me that don't make this protest about you. Don't come with this Nari Morcha Shakti Jhanda and all. This is a farmer movement. Let's, you know, focus on this. And I just told her after I visited to the protest, you know, with that emboldened resolve and seeing men cooking, like you said, women being on the front lines, there's a whole new world, and I'll come on to that, the landscaping of the whole you know, protest sites. And I'm like, you don't have to ask for somebody's permission, you don't have to let anybody else set the narrative for this farmers movement. You know, this, these farm laws are not just going to affect men, this is going to affect families, lives, communities, livelihoods. And who is to say that women have no role to play in that? Obviously, all the agencies and elements that we're talking about, obviously, women are the partakers, and, you know, they are at the helm of this.
You actually reminded me of something very interesting. So we did, in December itself, we did a day where we, humne anna tyag kiya tha annadata ke liye. We said that the idea was just to say that agar aapke subah se sham tak agar aapke thali pe khana nahi hoga, you will know the value of it, right? So we just did it, and we did it in, it was organized by the Gandhi Bhavan here in Bhopal. I was there. And this came up, okay? So hum log nare laga rahe the, aise baith ke gaane ga rahe the, nare laga rahe the. And this, okay, Kisan Shakti Zindabad, theek hai? Yuva Shakti Zindabad. And then somebody said Nari Shakti Zindabad, because you said Nari Shakti, right? And there's this amazing feminist in my city, in my local context, and we keep talking, and we just said, and we back and said, Nari Shakti alag se zindabad bolne ka kya matlab hai? Yuva nariyan nahi hoti hain kya? फार्मर्स नारियां नहीं होती हैं क्या, राइट, या लेबरर्स नारी नहीं होते हैं क्या? तो हमको ये अलग से बोलना पड़ता है, विच वन इट स्पीक्स फॉर इटसेल्फ दैट यू नो दे आर एनीवे नॉट मेनस्ट्रीम्ड, एंड आपको अलग से एक नारा लगाना पड़ता है कि नारी शक्ति जिंदाबाद. बट एट द सेम टाइम दिस आइडिया दैट ये आप हाईजैक मत करो, ये फार्मर मूवमेंट है, ये एक तरीके से ये कहना है कि फार्मर में तो औरतें भी होती है ना.
Because they are placed at the bottom of the food chain, like the data we quoted is exactly showing that deplorable picture that women are into the labor intensive things, not having access to credit, not having the knowledge of the market, not having those resources at hand. So they are, they don't have any job. But yeah, and ultimately it falls back on her. I have another thing to say, and which is, and you know, people can talk about it.
See, we know that women are performing very poorly in all development indicators. We talk about education, health, pay gap is bad. It's so disgusting sometimes to even talk about that women are barely paid for, you know, same labor. But so now what happens is it is these data points that women are only 65%, you know, the education within in women is 65% and men is at 84%. What this does is it acts as a double whammy. You know what? The people who should be doing something to correct this, they should be, you know, doing something to launch policies for women to get better educated, to come back into the workforce, to be intelligent or to be to know. इन लोगों का कहना ये है कि पहली बात तो औरतों को पता ही नहीं चल क्या. So what I'm trying to say, why it is a double whammy? So these people who should be working to improve these indicators quote the same things. कि अरे औरतें तो पढ़ी लिखी हैं ही नहीं. ये लोग, इनको तो पता ही नहीं कि क्या है फार्म बिल में क्या लिखा है. इनको तो जो पट्टी पढ़ा दी ये लोग आ गए. So instead of working on their education, they are using their illiteracy as an argument to discredit them. And how shameful is that? So
yes.
So instead of saying that women के तो बस 2% है लैंड फार्म ओनरशिप में, इंस्टेड ऑफ सेइंग दैट इतना वो काम करती है एंड वी शुड इंक्रीज दैट परसेंटेज, पीपल एंड इवन यू नो दे कुड बी यू नो को प्रोटेस्टर्स, दे कैन बी अगेन या एनीबॉडी, दे से आपका तो स्टेक ही नहीं है इसमें, आपका तो सिर्फ 2% है, आप लोग तो मतलब आप क्यों आ गए हैं उठ के, आप तो सब प्लेयर्स हैं, आप तो सब यू नो फार्म लेबरर्स हैं, यू हैव नो स्टेक, दिस इज द बिग गेम अबाउट बिग फार्मर्स selling big lands and big monies to these big corporates, aap log kyun involved ho rahe hain? So they are constantly talking about ki hum jo puri chain hai, hum sirf usme se top of the chain hai usse baat karna chahte hain. Ninth abhi ek ghante pehle ninth round of conversation chalu hui hai farmers aur apparently government ke beech mein Narendra Singh Tomar. To hum ye samajh rahe hain ki in what Gandhi ji said that, you know, you have to think about the last person in the queue. Here, we don't even look beyond the first. We say, we have placed so much importance on being the first in the game or being the larger person in the game that we continue to sideline everybody who's not that. So, women ka jo, humko ye bolna chahiye ki achha, ye log, inka ye kaise bada sakte hain? Jaise aapne bola ki, agar ye aage jata hai, to iska narrative ye banna chahiye. कि इसके बाद हमको औरतों की भागीदारी के बारे में बात करनी है, हमको इसके बारे में ये सोचना है कि हाउ कैन वुमेन आल्सो बेनिफिट फ्रॉम दीज इकोनॉमीज ऑफ स्केल्स इन एग्रीकल्चर. बट इंस्टेड ऑफ दैट वी आर सेइंग यू हैव सच लेस स्टेक, सो व्हाई आर यू इवन एट दिस प्रोटेस्ट? बिकॉज माय फाइट इज बिगर, माय फाइट इज नॉट ओनली विद द गवर्नमेंट, माय फाइट इज आल्सो विद द सिस्टम. एंड आई एम सेइंग दैट बस आप ये भी ठीक करो, इनको सब कुछ वापस लो एंड गिव मी मोर राइट्स. यू नीड टू लुक एट मी बिकॉज यू हैव नेवर कम टू माय विलेज एंड हैड अ यू नो कन्वर्सेशन विद मी. सो या
एग्जैक्टली, आई मीन यू नो दिस इज द रॉटन थिंकिंग ऑफ द सोसाइटी, एंड आई हेट टू से दीस वर्ड्स बट इट इज व्हाट इट इज. नोबडी इज टॉकिंग अबाउट मार्जिनलाइजेशन, नोबडी इज टॉकिंग अबाउट एडवोकेसी और यू नो पार्टिसिपेशन. यू डोंट हैव टू बी a political person to be associated with the farmers cause, right? I don't have any professed political inclination towards anything. I have opinions, I have political opinions, but if you know you associate yourself with farmers causes and movements, you don't have to necessarily worry about your political stance, your political thinking as such. And
can I just intervene and say that politics, yeah, this whole idea that you don't have to be political is because we keep thinking about politics in a very in a very narrow landscape, that it is party politics or electoral politics. What about the personal is political? What about the everyday I breathe, live, eat, not eat, get access to education, health, everything?
That is why the farmers movement is about political literacy as well. It is about, you know, spearheading and sort of changing that narrative, that instead of asking women as to what is their locus and I'm doing, you know, what they are doing in the farmer movements, you should instead talk about reforms that benefit them. You should instead talk about, you know, a time or a threshold of reforms that actually sort of improves their position in the workforce. So, we have with us Mr. Sandeep Pandey as well. He's a social activist, a rewarded, respected social activist who has been a grassroots, I'm using the word activist again. But he has been here to share his experience on social movements and role of women specifically in consolidating them and in, you know, providing structure and purpose to these social movements. So, yes, sir.
Thank you so much. Hello, Sandeep ji. Why am I calling myself G? Ignore that. Kangshi Agrawal.
आप मध्य प्रदेश में कहाँ से?
मैं वैसे तो अब क्या बोलूँ, मध्य प्रदेश में कोई मध्य प्रदेश से होता नहीं है, क्योंकि मेरे पिताजी जैसे बुंदेलखंड से हैं. और पर मैं भोपाल में रहती हूँ अभी.
अच्छा, चलिए, बहुत अच्छा लगा. मैं बस अपने कुछ अनुभव रखूंगा कि किस तरह से जब मौका मिलता है तो महिलाएं किस तरह से आगे बढ़ के अपने अधिकारों का इस्तेमाल करती हैं. और मुझे याद है हम लोग एक NREGA का एक सोशल ऑडिट कर रहे थे, 2006 की बात है जब वो कानून आया था. और एक गांव था हरदोई का, 2006 या 2007 की बात है. और वहां पे जब हमारी टीम पहुंची सोशल ऑडिट करने के लिए और पूछा गया कि ग्राम प्रधान कौन है, तो बताया गया कि एक महिला है, OBC कैटेगरी की थी वो. और वो उनके घर पे लोग पहुंचे तो वो झाड़ू लगा रही थी. तो हमारे साथियों ने पूछा कि भाई आप पता लगाए कि ग्राम प्रधान है? तो उसने बोला, अरे हम तो नाम के हैं, जो पहले जो ग्राम प्रधान थे अशोक सिंह जी, सारा कागज वगैरह वही रखते हैं, मेरे पास बस एक मोहर है, जब मुझसे साइन कराना होता है तो वो कागज लेके आते हैं और मोहर लगा के मैं साइन कर देती हूँ, बाकी मीटिंग में भी वही जाते हैं.
बिल्कुल.
तो हम लोगों को लगा कि भाई ये तो स्थिति ठीक नहीं है कि प्रधान कोई है और प्रधानी कोई और चला रहा है. तो इत्तेफाक से दूरदर्शन की एक टीम आई थी और उसने उसको हम लोग लेके गए सोशल ऑडिट के बाद ये गांव दिखाने, और उन्होंने उसका इंटरव्यू लिया. और वो इंटरव्यू कुल मिला के 5 मिनट का एक क्लिप दिखाया गया था, जिसमें छोटा सा हिस्सा ये भी दिखाया गया था कि एक गांव में किस तरह से एक महिला प्रधान है OBC की, और वो उसके पास सिर्फ रबर की मोहर है, और लिटरली जो अपर कास्ट का प्रधान है वो उसको रबर की मोहर की तरह इस्तेमाल कर रहा है. तो इतना कहना था कि वो इतना दिखाना था टीवी पे कि उसके पास फोन आने लगे अशोक सिंह के पास लोगों के, भाई ये तुम क्या कर रहे हो. और एक ऐसा उसके ऊपर दबाव बना, सामाजिक दबाव, कि उसने उस महिला को बुला के कहा कि भाई तुम मेरी क्यों बदनामी करा रही हो, ये सब तुम अपने रजिस्टर वगैरह तुम रखो और तुम ही प्रधानी चलाओ, हाँ मुझे कोई शौक नहीं है प्रधानी चलाने का. तो मेरा कहने का मतलब था कि कई बार हम मान लेते हैं कि ये जो पूरा हमारा फ्यूडल पेट्रियार्कल सिस्टम है इसमें महिलाएं कुछ कर नहीं सकती, लेकिन अगर कोई ठीक से थोड़ा सा एसर्ट करे अपने आप को और उसके साथ उसको कुछ थोड़ा सा सपोर्ट मिल जाए समाज से, तो बहुत मदद मिलती है. और वो महिलाएं फिर वाकई में अपनी भूमिका जो है, जो उनसे अपेक्षा की जाती है, उसको जो निभाना चाहिए वो निभाती भी हैं. हम लोग लखनऊ में, तो उसके बाद से वो महिला जो है उसने फिर वो प्रधानी का काम संभाल लिया और वो करने लगी। बस उसमें जरूरत थी कि किसी को बस कहने की जरूरत थी अशोक सिंह से कि भाई आप क्यों इसके अधिकार का आप हनन कर रहे हैं, आप इसको करने दीजिए अपना काम। लेकिन वो अपना जो पूरी अपना समाज है उसमें ये कहने की कोई हिम्मत ही नहीं रखता है, जो फ्यूडल पेट्रियार्कल कास्टिस्ट समाज है। तो दूसरा, हम लोगों ने लखनऊ में बहुत सारे गरीब परिवारों को जो सरकार की शहरी गरीब आवास योजना है उसके तहत आवास दिलवाए, उसमें कई बार ऐसा होता था कि जब आदमी के नाम पे घर होता है तो वो अपनी औरत को मारता पीटता है, कई बार निकाल भी देता है, दूसरी शादी कर लेता है, तो वो औरत बच्चों के साथ सड़क पे आ जाती है। तो हमने ये तय किया कि हम घर जो है औरत के नाम पे ही देंगे, तो हमारी जो भी लिस्टें बनती थी वो औरतों के नाम से बनती थी। उसका असर ये हुआ कि वो आज सारी लीडरशिप जो है घर की लड़ाई की लखनऊ के अंदर वो औरतों के हाथ में, और हमारी एक एक अनुसूचित जाति की साथी हैं गुड्डी, ये पत्थर का समुदाय है, पत्थर के सामान वगैरह ये लोग बेचते हैं, सिलबट्टा वगैरह। तो अब जो भी धरना प्रदर्शन होता है वो औरतों को लेके जाती है डिस्ट्रिक्ट मैजिस्ट्रेट के ऑफिस में और खुद वो जाके सारे अधिकारियों से बात करती है। मेरी भूमिका सिर्फ ये रहती है कि अगर कोई अधिकारी उसको समय नहीं दे रहा है क्योंकि बहुत भीड़ भाड़ है या उसकी बात ठीक से नहीं सुनता है, तब मैं कभी कभी चला जाता हूँ जब वो मुझे फोन करके बुलाती है कि भैया जी अब आप आ जाइए, नहीं तो वो मुझे बिना इन्फॉर्म किए सीधे जाके अधिकारियों से बात करती है, धरने प्रदर्शन कर लेती है अपनी महिलाओं को लेके, और कई बार अधिकारियों से अपने पक्ष में निर्णय भी करवा लेती। तो ये एक गजब का हम लोगों ने देखा कि एक अनपढ़ औरत, और अब मेरा ये पूरा मानना है कि समझदारी और अपने अधिकारों को हासिल करने के लिए पढ़ाई लिखाई की कोई जरूरत नहीं है। अगर आप समझदार हैं, अगर आप चीजों को समझ रहे हैं, इस सिस्टम को समझ रहे हैं, तो आप अपने अधिकारों के लिए लड़ सकते हैं, और उसका बहुत अच्छा उदाहरण ये गुड्डी है। और तीसरा उदाहरण मैं दूंगा कि इधर लॉकडाउन के बाद हम लोगों ने पहले तो रसोई चलाई, उसके बाद 5,000 के हमने लोन देने शुरू किए, और मैंने तो सिर्फ ये सुना था कि बांग्लादेश में जो ग्रामीण बैंक का प्रयोग है बहुत सफल रहा है महिलाओं के स्वयं सहायता समूह बना के, और अब मेरा ये प्रत्यक्ष अनुभव है कि लखनऊ के अंदर 300 से ज्यादा हम लोगों ने 5,000 के इंटरेस्ट फ्री लोन दिए, और ज्यादातर औरतों को ही दिया क्योंकि हमारा मानना था कि औरतें उसका इस्तेमाल बेहतर ढंग से करेंगी और ज्यादा जिम्मेदारी के साथ रीपेमेंट्स करेंगी, और हमारा अनुमान एकदम सही निकला। बड़ी अच्छी तरीके से लोन वापस आ रहे हैं, और इसमें भी गुड्डी ने तो कमाल कर दिया, उसको हम लोगों ने एक ग्रुप लोन दिया था क्योंकि उसका गांव यहाँ से 16 किलोमीटर दूर है, 16 या 20 किलोमीटर, तो हम लोगों ने उसको एक 60,000 का लोन दिया था कि आप ले जाइए और इससे जो गांव में आपके लोग हैं आप उनको कुछ रोजगार उनके लिए उपलब्ध कराइए। तो उन्होंने लखनऊ से कुछ प्लास्टिक की चटाइयाँ, वाइपर, डोरमैट्स वगैरह खरीदे और उनकी फेरी का काम, वेंडिंग का काम उनसे करवाया, और उसने सबसे पहले जो पूरा लोन वापस करने वाली महिला थी वो गुड्डी ही थी, जिसने कि पूरा का पूरा 60,000 का अमाउंट वापस ला के दे दिया, और अब दूसरा लोन ले लिया है और वो भी कल वो मुझे ला के लौटाने वाली। तो ये देखा जा रहा है कि अगर मौका मिले तो महिलाएं बिल्कुल अपनी जिम्मेदारी बहुत अच्छी तरह से निभाती हैं, और लीडरशिप के रोल में तो खैर बहुत ही जिम्मेदार होती हैं। मतलब मैं ये देख रहा हूँ कि आदमियों से ज्यादा जिम्मेदार वो, मतलब जिन आदमियों को हमने लोन दिए वो अभी तक वापस नहीं आए, उनके पीछे पड़ना पड़ता है, वो बहाने बनाते हैं, लेकिन इस मामले में भी औरतें ही ज्यादा जो जिम्मेदारी के साथ काम करती हैं। और आखिरी में मैं कहूँगा कि पाकिस्तान में मैंने एक बार एक नाटक देखा था, मेरी मित्र है कराची में रहती हैं, उनका एक नाटक का ग्रुप है, उन्होंने परफॉर्म किया था, शीमा किरमानी, मेरे ख्याल से उस ग्रुप का नाम है तहरीक निस्वा शायद नाम है उसका। तो वो नाटक में उन्होंने ये दिखाया था, सिंबॉलिक था, वो दो कबीले हैं और वो कबीले आपस में लड़ते हैं, वो सिंबॉलिक था इंडिया पाकिस्तान के बीच में जो दुश्मनी है, और एक कुछ ऐसा घटनाक्रम होता है कि पहले उनके पास खजाने की चाबी आ जाती है और उसके बाद फिर वो कबीले की जो लीडरशिप है वो भी इनके हाथ में आ जाती है, और उसके बाद वो कबीले जो कई लंबे समय से आपस में लड़ रहे होते हैं, उनको ये समझ में आता है महिलाओं को कि आखिर ये जो लड़ाई झगड़ा कर रहे हैं हम, ये इससे क्या हासिल कर पा रहे हैं। और जब वो उनकी जब बातचीत होने लगती है तो उनको लगता है कि ये तो बेकार में ही हम लड़ रहे हैं, और फिर दोस्ती हो जाती है। तो जो जो समस्या आदमी सॉल्व नहीं कर पा रहे थे, क्योंकि वो उनका जो उनकी जो पूरी सोच है एक फ्यूडल पेट्रियाकल जो अपने एक ईगो है, पावर है, वो सब हमारी जो शोभा शुक्ला जी हैं बहुत अच्छा कहती हैं कि फेमिनिज्म का मतलब है सॉलिडैरिटी, शेयरिंग, ये सब। तो वो जो गुण है औरतों के अंदर, जिसकी वजह से जो पूरा एनवायरनमेंट मूवमेंट है, इसमें सवाल पूछा है अंकित ने कि ये एनवायरनमेंट मूवमेंट बहुत सारे जो है महिलाओं की लीडरशिप में चल रहे हैं, तो वंदना शिवा तो बाकायदा कहती हैं कि एनवायरनमेंट मूवमेंट के लिए इको सोशलिज्म व्यू पॉइंट की जगह इको फेमिनिज्म, अगर हम फिलॉसफी से हम चीजों को देखें तो हमें बेहतर समझ में आएगा कि किस तरह से महिलाएं जो है पर्यावरण के आंदोलनों में भी ज्यादा पुरुषों से संवेदनशील है, और इसीलिए शायद ज्यादातर जो आंदोलन है पर्यावरण को लेके, चाहे वो नर्मदा बचाओ आंदोलन हो या फ्राइडेज फॉर फ्यूचर हो, उसकी लीडरशिप महिलाओं के हाथ में। जरूरत बस अब मुझे ये लगता है कि अभी पॉलिटिकल लीडरशिप महिलाओं के हाथ में नहीं है, जिससे आपने कांक्षी जी ने अपनी बातचीत की शुरुआत की थी। तो पंचायत में तो हमारे लोगों ने मान लिया है कि 33% रिजर्वेशन महिलाओं को मिलेगा, और खुशी की बात है कि वो 33% से ज्यादा सीटों पे जीत के आती है।
जी जी जी
हाँ, लेकिन असेंबली और पार्लियामेंट में वो हमारे लोग अभी तैयार नहीं हो रहे हैं इसके लिए। और खास करके बहुत दुख की बात है कि जो ओबीसी लीडरशिप है वो इसका विरोध करती है, लालू, मुलायम वगैरह इस तरह के लोग, क्योंकि वो कहते हैं कि अगर 33% रिजर्वेशन हो जाएगा तो सब वो अपर कास्ट की पढ़ी लिखी महिलाएं आ जाएंगी। तो भाई इसमें दिक्कत क्या है? आप जो भी आप रिजर्वेशन तय करें, होना तो कायदे से 50% चाहिए, आप उसके सब डिविजन बना दीजिए। जो भी कास्ट का प्रोपोर्शन है पॉपुलेशन में, अगर ओबीसी 50% है तो 50% में 50% यानी 25% आप ओबीसी को दे दीजिए, आप 14% एससी को दे दीजिए, आप 14% मुस्लिम्स को दे दीजिए। तो इस प्रॉब्लम का इतना आसान हल है, लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि जो मेल लीडरशिप है, पॉलिटिकल लीडरशिप, आपको बड़े मजे की बात बताऊं कि हमारी सोशलिस्ट पार्टी में हमने निर्णय लिया है कि हमारे हमारे कैंडिडेट्स में कम से कम आधी जो है महिलाएं होनी चाहिए। लेकिन एक दुर्भाग्य है कि जब नॉमिनेशन करने जाते हैं तो बहुत सारी महिलाएं अपना नॉमिनेशन फॉर्म ठीक से भर नहीं पाती हैं, तो अल्टीमेटली कैंडिडेट्स जो हैं जब बनते हैं तो उसमें 50% वो नहीं रह पाती, लेकिन हम नॉमिनेट तो करते हैं 50% से ज्यादा महिलाओं को। एक बार सोशलिस्ट पार्टी की मीटिंग में मैंने जब ये प्रस्ताव रखा कि भाई हमारी 50% कैंडिडेट्स और 50% ऑफिस बेयरर्स महिलाएं होनी चाहिए, तो हमारे एक बहुत वरिष्ठ जो मेल साथी थे उन्होंने कहा कि फिर हम लोग क्या करेंगे। तो ये जो मानसिकता है, पुरुषों को डर लगता है कि जब महिलाएं आ जाएंगी तो हमारी फिर हमारी जो कुछ भी हमारा एक है वर्चस्व या जो भी हम कर रहे हैं, हमारी एक पोजीशन ऑफ अथॉरिटी है, वो चली जाएगी। ये जो पुरुषों के मन के अंदर डर है, इस वजह से भी बहुत सारे निर्णय नहीं हो पाते हैं। लेकिन मुझे लगता है धीरे धीरे माहौल बदल रहा है और अब ज्यादा लोग इस बात को स्वीकार करने को तैयार है कि महिलाएं भी महत्वपूर्ण पदों पे बैठें और निर्णय लें, और मुझे लगता है कि पॉलिटिकल लीडरशिप भी महिलाओं के हाथ में आना बहुत जरूरी है। देखिए न्यूजीलैंड की जो प्राइम मिनिस्टर है, सबसे अच्छी तरीके से कोविड को अगर किसी ने मैनेज किया, और जो वहाँ टेररिस्ट अटैक हुआ था उसके बाद जिस तरह से उसने उसको हैंडल किया, उसकी तारीफ पूरी दुनिया में हो रही है, और पहली महिला है जो अपने छोटे बच्चे को लेके भी मीटिंग्स अटेंड करती है। तो उसने बहुत सारे ऐसे जो मिथक थे उनको तोड़ा कि महिलाएं जो है जब उनके उनको छोटे बच्चे को देखना होगा तब वो कैसे जिम्मेदारी निभाएंगी। तो इन सारे मिथकों को उसने तोड़ा है, और ये बहुत अच्छी बात है कि इस तरह की लीडरशिप उभरी है। मैं देख रहा हूँ कितनी भारतीय मूल की महिलाएं इंग्लैंड और अमेरिका के अंदर वो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट पॉलिटिकल पोजीशंस में आ गई हैं, लेकिन हिंदुस्तान में अभी ऐसा नहीं हुआ है, तो यहाँ होने की जरूरत है। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
So yeah, I mean, thank you so much, sir, for you know sharing your experiences. And this just, मतलब ये सिर्फ पता लगता है कि if you give resources, if you give the right avenues, and why only I should not be even saying give. I mean, I don't know why we have to give. It is women have to reclaim. They're in that position where you have to reclaim. And this farmer movement is about reclaiming those rights. It's about reclaiming all those avenues and all those rightful, you know, what can we say? Parameters or indicators to which you know the sector needs to be saved from these you know the demands that are basically being raised by the farmers. So you know, coming back to you know the discussion which was happening about you know the role of women leadership and the fact that there has to be eco-feminism or there has to be you know a feminist approach that has to be adopted when it comes to social movements, and rightly so. It is, you know, the basic approach that can consolidate, that can lay down the foundations. And I know from personal experience, when I visited the protest site, you know, it forces us to break away from those patriarchal structures. It forces us to rethink those shackles that unfortunately, you know, surround our thinking and makes us question these obnoxious things, like not raising the question of political participation, or not, you know, giving the platform or not giving the chance for women to advocate what's rightfully theirs. So yeah, I mean, we can have the closing comments, and I think somebody has raised their hand. If I mean, it's from quite a while now. I'll unmute him.
I just want to say thank you first to Sandeep sir. I think I completely loved what he had what he has shared, and I am so in like I think that this was one of those 15 minutes where he shared so many different beautiful examples, and yes sir, and I am so glad that you know you brought that perspective that within Socialist Party you are reserving and sort of giving that 50% to women, and also highlighted men's insecurities so well. But would love to get in touch, because this is exactly what we are trying to do at Netri Foundation. So aapne jab nomination ki jaise patra ki baat ki, hum jab Harda mein the, to humne yahi to ek prakriya jo hum karte hain, jo jispe hum thoda sa kaam karte hain, wo ye hai ki nomination kaise sahi bhara jaye, kyunki bahut rejections hote hain. और हाउ कैन वी मतलब थोड़े टाइम इसको परफेक्ट कैसे कर सकते हैं, क्या इसके अराउंड हम कुछ एक ऐसा सिस्टम बना सकते हैं कि औरतों को वो नॉलेज एक्सेसिबल हो जाए. सो दैट इज समथिंग दैट वाज वंडरफुल दैट आई लर्न्ड फ्रॉम सर.
एंड आई थिंक व्हाट ही सेड इज समथिंग दैट वी मिस्ड आउट, दैट व्हाई डू मेन हैव टू फियर व्हेन वुमेन कम इनटू पोजीशंस ऑफ पावर. दैट इज रियली आई मीन फनी. आई मीन आई कैन अंडरस्टैंड दैट देयर कमिंग फ्रॉम अ पोजीशन ऑफ you know whatever, but anyways, there's nothing to fear. I think the whole point of feminism, the whole point of empowerment in social movements is about solidarity, right? So we can have a question from Mr. Gulzar, who's raised his hand, and I've unmuted him as sure. well, and then we can have the closing comments of the session. Sir, do you want to say something?
Good evening to all.
Hanji,
good evening. I was sharing with a great patience today, because from last couple of days we were concerned with these three agriculture laws, but today the topic was a little bit different, which is concerned with the woman empowerment. I heard Madam Agarwal with a great patience in continuation. Pandey sir beautifully explained the basics, what is happening on ground basis. In the meantime, we all know that at the global levels, women are doing exceptionally well. Either she's Angela Merkel, Hillary Clinton, or the Prime Minister of New Zealand. Similarly, in India, the women's got the opportunity to climb the highest post, either it is Prime Minister Indira Gandhi or Pratibha Devi Singh Patel. Similarly, the highest post of defense minister was conquered by the Nirmal Sitharaman. So if we go beyond, as we are an orthodox society, but if I concerned with our native state, which is Punjab, mm-hmm. but in the scenario is little bit different from rest of the country. What is happening in Punjab, we are little bit different. In our state, women are equally empowered, because 500 years back, Guru Nanak Dev Ji said, so ke manda akhe jit jamme rajan. So in our, we are from Punjab, in every home, every house, woman has the equal respect. In continuation, in the recent panchayat election, Punjab was the only state who gave 50% seats to the women. So this is, if when we condemn something, in the meantime, we should appreciate the positive movements which is happening here in Punjab.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, states have always
been. I think Punjab is the only state where 50% nominations came from the women sections. And in the meantime, women are doing exceptionally well. I think this should not be the questions. We should not be gender biased. As Mr. Pandey said, the Prime Minister of New Zealand is doing well. I got an opportunity to go to New Zealand in 2017. 3 years back, I went to New Zealand for 1 month. And what I noticed there, there is no difference between male and female. I used to, since I am an early riser, I get up early in the morning. When I go for a walk, there was the place where I stayed in just radius of 1 kilometer, there was a very good park. That was Hamilton Park. I get up early and went there. What is culture in New Zealand? When you are walking, if anybody sees you, either she is 15 years old girl or 30 years old lady or 50 years old male. When somebody when you got an eye contact with anyone, everybody will wish you. But there is no difference ke she is girl or she is lady. Everybody will wish you. That thing I noticed there. I think this when we will got these customs in our society, the women will surely empowered. Then nobody will stop. So these are the my words. I think we should take the reforms from the grassroots level. And in the our stage, since I am Madam Trishanjit knows I am having single daughter, and most of the time my parents, my family members, she's 7 years old. They used to said there should be one male. I never said no. There is no difference between I am having daughter. That's enough. I will educate her. I will give her an opportunity to rise in the society. There is no difference. So whenever we each and everyone will have the same mentality, then nobody will stop for the woman empowerment.
Right, absolutely, sir. I mean, and there's a whole thing boils down to, you know, having that kind of mentality, which is exactly what we're talking about, which is about, you know, having that renewed understanding of gender. And gender, when I talk about feminism, you cannot understand feminism without, you know, advocating for intersectionality. You cannot advocate for feminism until and unless you don't have the knowledge of intersectionality and, you know, the ground level, grassroots knowledge of, you know, feminism and about caste and all those oppressive structures that we were talking about in the beginning. So, I mean, thank you so much, Kankashi, and all the best for your Netri Foundation vision and the mandate and, you know, the motivation with which you work. I mean, I know, like, I've been, you know, moderating these sessions, and I sometimes, like, honestly, like, sometimes I do lack the motivation when I see that people, you know, don't turn up in the numbers. And then I just think to myself, and I think about people like you, and I think about people like Sandeep Pandeyji, who have devoted all their lives for empowering, you know, marginalized people, for empowering the downtrodden. And you have to believe in something that is larger than yourself. You have to believe in a cause that is so much bigger than your own self, than your own understanding. And that is something that struck my, struck me when I was thinking about doing a session with you, which was about role of women. And I was reading a couple of articles, but I could not, draw something conclusive or draw something that was coming out in the mainstream media. And I'm not saying that the mainstream media is a champion when it comes to covering these protests. But what I'm saying is that this is an aspect that deserved a lot of attention. And this is something that had to be critically evaluated, analyzed in terms of reforms that the farm bills can or cannot bring about, and also largely about the unsaid or the unsung role of women, not just from a socioeconomic point of view, but also from a point of view that cements their role in the social movements, that proves beyond a doubt that social movements, whether it is in the environment sphere or whether it is about the farming sector, or it is about feminism, or it is about anything that has the potential to change our lives or to change any walk of life. It is about the role of women. It is about their agency. It is about ultimately strengthening their right over agency. And nobody used to say that what business do they have, or they are not supposed to be at the protest site, or they are not a core part of the agricultural workforce or agricultural sector. So on this note, I would just like to have your closing comments, and then we can call the session, we can culminate the session.
So thank you again. As I said, I heard Dr. Sandeep Pandey very intently, and right now even a participant was speaking, and it keeps on bringing me back to the focal point where we start and say, how long, in what direction do we have to keep fighting this good fight of bringing and mainstreaming gender in our discourse? Whenever we talk about this and we say that, why talk about women? It is exactly where you need to talk about women.
Yeah.
Wherever there is a question, why are we bringing gender? Definitely think for a moment. There is definitely a need to discuss it at that point. Because what we see, and I always say, and this is my pet thing to go back to, saying patriarchy, politics, and power, right? It is ultimately intertwined in a way that politics and patriarchy is all about controlling power, and is all about getting to decide. Now, because we come from a patriarchal society, for long, this power has rested with a certain gender, with a certain caste, with a certain race, with certain religions, whatever it is. But what the point being, that we need to disbalance this so that, and there will always be, an imbalance in power sharing. It will never be equal. Even when we talk here, there is a, power dynamic. And for us to understand that better, to negotiate that space better, is what the constant struggle. This is a never ending struggle, but how close can we get to the fulcrum is all the fight about. And as I said, I'll share something that I was, I woke up to, and I was very upset about. In my state, the CM has come up with two very interesting propositions. One, to increase women's age to get married from 18 to 21. But he backed it with something like women need to, whenever they go out to work, they need to register in the local police station and they will be traced. To this, there was a rebuttal from the opposition MLA saying, but why is the change in age being proposed by the current CM? Women can also reproduce at 15. So this, in the last few years, we have seen that, women shouldn't be kept at protest. Women are paid $100 to show up at protest. Women should be tracked for their movement and their participation in labor force, and if they go out of their house to work. Women can give birth at 15, so why bother getting them married at 21? Just get them married at the moment they come to productive age. Upper caste women were being given money to marry a Brahmin in Karnataka and being given bonds, insurance bonds to get married to a priest. Women are being thought of as such agents, as such bodies, as such, you know, as such, they're not even being considered people here. You know, they're being considered cattle sometimes. I feel like, you know, you can buy...
Subjects of governance.
Subject of control. Subject of, oh my God, she'll pollute our caste. What, you know, Baba Saab Ambedkar talked about in Annihilation of Caste, the pollution of the caste concept and everything. And women cannot be taken out of the caste gender conversation. Like, you know, gender cannot be taken out of the caste conversation. So what I'm trying to say is that it is such a holistic fight, and we all need to fight it. So at all levels, and this protest is actually again cementing that belief that women are at the forefront of the labor, they are at the forefront of the work, and they are at the forefront of even bearing the brunt of climate change. You know, the climate crisis sort of impacts
exactly women. all of these laws, all of these rapid amendments that are happening are going to disproportionately impact women,
right?
So they are the key stakeholders in these fights, right?
So instead of saying because they are less educated and they don't have they don't own farmlands, one has to think about how to improve that and make this protest a starting point in that conversation. Because there was a bill, I think in 2013, which lapsed, which was going to talk about women's participation in agricultural and how that agricultural workforce and how that can be, you know, brought in and, you know, legislated upon. But we are not legislating on right things, on women issues in this country right now. And what we really need is a gender lens in the government. That's about that. And thank you for hosting me. Thank you for hosting me alongside Dr. Sandeep Pandey. Thank you for hosting me on this platform. Keep fighting the good fight. All the best to you.
Thank you so much. With faith and solidarity, we just hope and pray for more power and more good resolve to take this fight forward as long as and whatever it takes, you know, to just renew the basis of conversation, celebrate those about whom, you know, there's not much conversation in mainstream media noise. And that's what we are for. And you know, all our policy education and all our legal background and whatever disciplines we come from, they don't serve any purpose if we cannot lend voice to those who deserve that kind of, you know, who deserve that attention, who deserve mainstreaming of their struggles, right? And we are not appropriating anything. We are basically, you know, what we are saying is that don't let anybody else define their journeys. Don't let, like you say, we idolize a woman, we idolize, you know, political participation of women. But when it comes to grassroots level change, makeshift change, that is not something we are ready to, you know, talk about. And this movement is proving a point, you know, in a way, like you said, breaking away from the shackles of social structures, but also, you know, I would say it is also about, I mean, I'm falling short of words, but also about proving that, you know, there can be no social movement without women, as I've already reiterated.
Absolutely.
And thank you so much again for, you know,
there can be no society without women. So
there can be no society without women. And, you know, I think it's time we stop telling, and I think it is just time that we stop telling what women should demand, because they know their demands very well. They know their stakeholder, they know their role, and they know their you know, level of extent of involvement in this. And all we should do is support and empower them instead of
I'm just leaving my contact details if anybody wants to get in touch. I would love to speak with you, and thank you so much for just having me on this platform.
And for everybody here, do check out the great work that Netri Foundation you know, does about political empowerment, about social movement, and you know, so you can, you know, just get in touch with Pinkashi for
if anybody wants to fight the good fight, please come on board. If anybody wants to fight this good fight of, you know, bringing more women into politics, reclaiming that space.
They're very rare. They're very few people. They're very rare people who actually turn up and who are willing to have that conversation, and you're one of the few ones, and you'll always have my tremendous respect and admiration for that. So looking thank forward you. To engage with you further, and thank you so much again, and thank you everybody who joined us for this engaging conversation. And the farmer struggles and the women who are sitting on the borders rest in our hearts, and you know, all our prayers and all our strength. And
long live revolution. That's yes. That's about that.
Right. Thank you and good night. Have a safe day. Bye.